The battle in Oregon over physician-assisted suicide has been going on at the ballot box, in the courts, and in the legislature since 1994. That year, Oregon voters approved a ballot initiative allowing doctors to prescribe lethal medication if a terminally ill patient of sound mind requests it. A second doctor has to agree the patient is terminally ill. Immediately, a federal judge issued an injunction against the law, saying it failed to protect depressed, judgment-impaired people from suicide. An appellate court in San Francisco struck down that ruling, but the law stayed on hold as the case was appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court. Ironically, in the meantime, two landmark rulings which give the states the right to ban assisted suicide came out of the Supreme Court. The court let stand laws in New York and Washington state that prevent assisted suicide. Justices said there is no constitutional right to suicide. But the court also suggested, just as states can ban the practice, they can decide for themselves if they want to allow it. Last month, the High Court ruled on the Oregon case. It refused to hear the challenges to Oregon's law. That was effectively a legal go-ahead for the state to try its right-to-die law. But before that could happen, Oregon voters had to decide on a new ballot measure that would repeal the law. Placed on the ballot by the legislature, the emotional campaign was led by the Catholic Church. The campaign spent $4 million trying to convince voters that people who choose assisted suicide might not die immediately.
And in 15 minutes, a doctor is going to give him a lethal drug prescription. But what Billy doesn't know is that he won't die right away. He'll choke on his own vomit in painful convulsions and linger for days.
Those who supported the right to die countered with an appeal to individual rights.
I'm 80 years old and I intend to live a long time. But how I die is up to me, not some crackpot politicians in Salem.
Of course, a lot of celebrating for the No on 51 campaign.
Early this month, Oregon voters refused to revoke the right to die law by a resounding 60-40% margin and seemed to open the way for assisted suicide. But the federal government then stepped in. Prodded by Senators Orrin Hatch of Utah and Henry Hyde of Illinois, both opponents of assisted suicide, the U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency threatened Oregon doctors who aid in a suicide with the loss of their privilege to prescribe medicine. Doctors need DEA approval to prescribe drugs. Oregon doctors like Peter Goodwin are stunned by the threat.
It tells me that the DEA just doesn't understand the reality of death in America. That this is an appropriate, reasonable, rational response to a problem that patients perceive, but the DEA in their ivory tower doesn't.
Members of Oregon's congressional delegation bristled at what they call federal interference. Well, Senator Ron Wyden says Oregonians definitively voted no when asked to surrender their right to die.
And my question today is, what part of no does the federal government fail to understand?
But assisted suicide critics, like Portland psychiatrist Greg Hamilton, say the issue is about far more than states' rights.
The people of Oregon have unleashed a terrible tragedy, not only on this state, but on other states in America, across America, and the world. It's entirely appropriate for the DEA to enforce federal laws requiring that Oregonians, as well as other Americans, use drugs to heal people and not to kill them.
It's unclear how aggressive the Clinton administration will be against Oregon doctors. Attorney General Janet Reno criticized the DEA for threatening doctors before a full Justice Department review of Oregon's law is complete. She said that review will be completed as soon as possible. In the meantime, church leaders and other suicide opponents are threatening another lawsuit to keep the law from being implemented.